Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Give us the strength, the courage, and the direction to do the business of Alamance County and do it in the best interest of Alamance County. Amen.
Amen. Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, David. I'd like to now call the first Commissioners' Meeting of 2013 to order. Welcome to all of you. Thanks for being here and braving the cold weather outside. You should have, or you can have, a copy of the agenda. It's still floating around. We have, are those outside? Before we enter into the public comment section, which is the first item on the agenda, I did want to make note that we are going to remove item number 7, which is the staffing and retention proposal originally proposed by the Sheriff's Department. And I say that before public comments because in the event anyone was going to speak on that topic, we will not be discussing that tonight at our meeting. You can certainly speak on that topic or any one that you want, but I did want to make that clarification. The reason that we're pulling item number 7 is the Sheriff's Department wants to have a little bit more time to get some information together to present to county staff and to the board, and also to eliminate any confusion that may have arisen by some of the different parties receiving information at different times. So what we're going to do is invite the sheriff, along with other department heads, to present ideas for next year's budget as we begin the budgeting process, which actually starts during the month of February, and we'll be able to hear the presentation along with any other information at the budget retreat, which we have a tentative date, but we may need to move due to potential schedule conflicts. So that's the reason that we're going to remove or postpone that item at this time. So with that said, I would like to now begin the public comments. We originally had 5 people signed up, and the first speaker is Mr. Jim Allen. Mr. Allen, welcome.
Thank you. I hope you all are doing well this evening. I know it's very cold. I'm going to be brief. While I was in Ohio working directly for a presidential campaign, I got a little clip of one of these hearings, and a gentleman stood up and had some disparaging remarks about our sheriff. I'd like to let you guys know I've met tens, and I mean tens of thousands of people from Ohio to Minnesota to Indiana and throughout those 3 states. I've got a little bit of an accent, so I would repeatedly be asked, you know, where are you from? Are you from Texas? They confuse my accent. I even get that here sometimes. But I just want to let you guys know our sheriff is very popular throughout those 3 states. And you guys just need to know that. He's always spoken of, he's well known, and in a bright light. And I'm really defensive about the other comments that were made. I wasn't just working out of town and somebody said something. I'm talking about thousands of folks here, thousands of folks, and hundreds of those thousands know our sheriff and respect our sheriff, and Jim Allen respects him too. So I'd like to ask the county, who's going to stand for Terry Johnson? Jim's going to stand for Terry Johnson. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Allen. Next is Peter Childers. I'd like to talk about taxes. Mr. Childers, welcome to you.
Yeah, good evening, everyone. All the best for 2013 to all of you. I was going through the videos of the past meetings, and on December the 3rd, Commissioner Smith proposed that
the commissioners asked the state legislature to raise the county sales tax by 1 cent for 2 years, I believe it was. And then consequently, he proposed that after that was passed, the county could reduce the property taxes by 5 cents. And any difference that would show up would be put into the fund balance. I really don't think that commissioners need state legislatures to do their dirty work for them. I really don't. I think we need to take responsibility for our own decisions here on raising or not raising taxes and whatever, and the budgetary decisions that everyone makes. You know, we'd end up putting the onus on the state legislators to look like the bad guys, and then we'd come in with a with a property tax reduction of 5 cents and come out looking like heroes, and I don't think that's the responsible thing to do. So I just think we need to go ahead and forge our own solutions to this. And I really don't think that we need short-term solutions on this. Getting some kind of trick funding mechanism to take this county forward is really not the long-term solution for what this county needs to look for in planning for the future. We recently saw that the county taxpayers voted for a new ACC facility that commissioners were in favor of, Chamber of Commerce was in favor of, but then they voted against any method to pay for it. I don't really know what the voters were thinking of, but that facility would have helped this county in the long term. And I think the voters basically were cutting off their nose to spite their face, if you want to coin a term. It just appears to confirm my belief that voters always want a solution that's not going to cost them anything. And the hard decisions in this county will cost everybody something. But hopefully the solutions that it brings for the future of this county will be much better than the short-term pain. And I think the county must face up to the fact that to move this county forward, it will be necessary to raise property taxes. We just can't go on forever at the present property tax rate unless our county property valuations start to go up, which I don't see them doing that very quickly. You know, it seems too that we've taken this policy of using incentives to attract corporations to this county that pay low wages, and we give them a multi-year refund on their property taxes, and that just doesn't seem to be working.
Thank you, Mr. Childers.
So, and I'd also like to say that the county staff deserves a pay raise and not just a $500 bonus.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Just point of clarification,
sure.
I know we don't normally respond to public comment, but by law, had we decided to proceed with an increase in the sales tax, we would have no choice but to seek approval.
Well, I understand that even for a bond referendum,
yeah,
you need to do that.
Okay, I just want to make sure
that's fine.
That.
Sure, I understand.
Okay. All right, our next speaker is Mr. Barry Joyce. Barry?
I'm going to stand here, Tom, because I got a few things here.
Well, actually, we need you to come to the mic so that people that are not in this room are able to hear you as well. Welcome to you.
How you doing? Well, first thing I wanted to ask you guys about is a little bit about the county raises. I done a little study here of Alamance County, and according to the statistics I got off the computer, the government of Alamance County's average salary is $45,326. I guess that's the average of all government employees put together. I think with the economy being like it's been in this county, which has been terrible for the last 6 or 7 years and still is, that there are companies out there that haven't given raises in 6 or 7 years. The banking industry, as you know, most of them have cut out their 401ks. They don't have any health benefits. I think the taxpayers of this county have suffered tremendously in the last 5 or 6 years. I think you've got, according to this, you've got a 12.1 true actual unemployment rate in Alamance County. I don't think you'll have a problem filling these folks' jobs if they want to go somewhere else. If they want to leave, let them leave. There's 100 people waiting in line to take their place. And I really think that the only folks in this county that do deserve a raise are the Sheriff's Department and those folks, because we are spending a lot of money training those folks to go somewhere else and go to work. Plus, as Terry and I have talked about several times, with the unemployment rate in this county the way it is, there's only one thing that's going to happen in Alamance County, and that's crime is going to increase. Because we do not have, as these people run out of unemployment, out of benefits from the government, they're going to do whatever it takes to live, okay? And most of the time, that's resort to crime. And I'll have to say that Terry's office has been excellent in everything I've seen him do. I've been retired from Summers Party for 8 years, and I've had a lot of time to ride around this county and see the kind of waste that was going on in this county. And there's a tremendous amount of waste in government in this county. I looked at the organizational chart before I came down here, and it has at the top of that organizational chart the Alamance County Citizens. Well, I think what's happened is that block's been moved around to the bottom, and it's time for the people of Alamance County, the citizens, to be considered first, not last. I'm going to give you some examples of the things. I just heard, read in the paper here a while back where you guys put a gym in for the county employees. The people of Alamance County, if they want to be in a gym, they have to join. They have to pay. You know, I don't think it's right for the taxpayers of Alamance County to put a gym in for the employees of Alamance County. I mean, you know, if I want to go to a gym, I got to pay. The guy that runs the hobby horses, the guy that makes minimum wage, he's got to pay. I mean, I don't know what you guys are thinking. I mean, you know, you got to be somewhere out there somewhere. Plus, a gym for employees at a county level, you're not asking but for one thing. And that's a sexual harassment lawsuit. I guarantee it won't be a year you'll have that gym, and you'll have a sexual harassment lawsuit.
Thank you, Barry.
Okay?
Appreciate your time.
Next one. No, I've got some more.
Barry, we have a three-minute limit on public comment.
Well, let me say one more thing.
Barry, thank you for being here. It's good to see you.
Okay.
Well, time for the next speaker. Who is Mr. Tony Cox? Wants to talk about ordinances. Tony, welcome to you.
Thank you, Commissioners. With ordinances, we've had a lot of people come up in here over the last several years with a lot of stories that just, if you check out the facts of the stories, they're not panning out. It appears that in Alamance County, we got a sheriff that is duly sworn with police officers to enforce our laws, but yet our sheriff has said over the last year or two that we have unenforceable ordinances by the sheriff's department. And then it goes to the planning department. And we're being charged with crimes out here in the neighborhood for ordinance violations, and we have no rights in these. It's a courtesy to have a right to you know, our constitutional rights. Judge, I've got horror stories in here. Just because I tried to stand up, Deborah Prince, a landowner in Alamance County who was just trying to pay her taxes and her insurance on her land out there, was charged with crimes. And I own the junkyard. We made it clear that I own the junkyard. Larry Shambly come in here. We got the high impact land use ordinance rescinded last year. Larry Shambly come to this podium and told lies on me, clear lies. Talking about that I own land next door to him, that I had sold him land, and that I was putting in a junkyard. And I don't own land on Mine Creek Road. I've never sold him anything. And it's not just there. It's in other places. Y'all remember Mr. Squires out here on McCray Road? He's been sent a letter now that he might be violating a junk car ordinance. People are scared out there, and they can't defend themselves. We need help. You know, we try to call, and if we make somebody mad, good God, I've been intimidated. I've been threatened to be put in jail. Tony, go on and forget about what we've done. Go on and shut your mouth or we're going to lock you up. Threatened with bloody physical violence on the radio out here, WBAG talk line, for trying to show people what's going on with this. We need help. These people, why is it a courtesy in America to have a right? Seriously. Thank you.
Call our last speaker, Mr. Eddie Hsu. Eddie wants to talk about money. Welcome, sir.
Good evening, Commissioner, Mr. Chairman. Before I get to the money part, I want to talk about all these double lost files we got, whatever. This gets off confusion when it comes out in the paper. Mr. Smith here not long ago had this secret plan to get money. Now Terry's got a secret plan to get money. Now it's off the agenda because apparently that y'all all didn't know the whole details. There's no way to run a county. I don't know what to tell y'all. You know where our money lies, how much money we got. I sat here and heard the county employees come in wanting money, maybe a year ago, was it? There's a bunch of them that wanted. Then we went to the courthouse, and all the teachers and school people were there to fill the place up out in the street wanting money. And everybody wound up cut. And then here we come up with some more magic money, which not going to cost the county. I don't know where the money's going to come from, whether it was like the paper said or not. But by gosh, it's county money. It's taxpayer money. I don't care if it's a federal grant. It's taxpayer money. It's real money. Now, my thermostat set on 66 today. It's cool in there, but I got a jacket. I'm lucky. I bought a girl a heater down here that me and the wife grew up with, a little extra heater for her trailer. And she only runs it a few hours at a time. I mean, you want to go down and get in the car right down and see. I ain't been down there since Christmas. But we'll ride down and check the temperature in that place right now if you want to. You don't have to, people have to live out here. You just know how you live. You know, you can turn the thermostat up and cuss the heat bill. And some people can't turn the thermostat up because if they do, they ain't going to have no heat because they're going to cut it. So as you go about making these decisions and you hear these horror stories of how broke everybody is, you need to think how lucky we are and that there's people out there by the bunches that are not nearly as lucky as we are. I can sit and look around my neighborhood and see things have went from bad to miserable, especially for some of the older folks. I worry, I watch, because I want to be sure the lights come on in the morning when they're supposed to, and stuff like that, because it has got that bad. And y'all can play political games, do whatever, but a lot of people live in the real world. And wish y'all would consider that when you do this under the table, back and forth, whatever it is. Thank you.
Thank you, Eddie.
I didn't get a chance to sign in to speak, but is it any way possible, please?
Under the public comment, yes, come forward.
Thank you.
Please introduce yourself and tell us what you'd like to talk about. And our public comment is 3 minutes.
My name is Felicia Richmond McCaster, and I am an Alamance County citizen. And I wanted to talk about the raise that you all give in the Sheriff Department and where I think that the city really need to think about auditing the Sheriff Department, the Burlington Police, because we have a lot of drug raids. We are one of the fifth largest cities in the nation for drugs. And the money, we are so poor. The people are so poor. It is outrageous. And in North Park, it is not, the parks are not there, the merry-go-rounds, anything. Where is the money? Could we please have an audit before we give out anything? We, the people, would like to have an audit, or at least from 25 years back, or maybe 10. And then we can follow the money, we can find out how it's coming through and where it is before we can give out some money. The people need to be taken care of. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks to all who came to public comment. At this time, as a result of any public comment, are there any commissioners' responses? If not, let's move to item number 4, which is the approval of the agenda. Commissioners, County Manager, please take a moment and review the agenda. As I mentioned earlier, we are going to remove item number 7 from the agenda. Is there any other proposed change, or is there any item on consent agenda that any commissioner would like to have removed? Mr. Honeycutt, do you have any changes to the agenda?
No, sir.
If there are no changes, I would like to entertain a motion for approval of the agenda, which would include the items on the consent agenda. Is there such a motion?
So moved.
Thank you, Bill. Linda's a second. Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you. It is now my pleasure to recognize a very special individual who is here with us tonight. And as I begin, this is item number 6 on the agenda. As I begin this process, I'd like to first call on Mr. Frank Bell. Mr. Bell is involved with as chairman of our Board of Equalization and Review, and he would like to make a few comments on someone that we are honoring this evening. Mr. Bell, welcome to you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, fellow commissioners. It gives me great honor to be able to speak about a man that I think very highly of. Mr. Bill Covington has been in this county some 83 years. He's served on the Equalization Board for many years. The only comment that I can make that I could think of, that if every citizen of his county had contributed to their community and to this county in the same proportion that Bill Covington has, it would be a wonderful place to live. Bill, I'm grateful for the opportunity to have served with you on the Board of Equalization. We've had some pretty tough times in the last 3 years, several thousand appeals. But through it all, my man, we're a better organization today than we were 3 years ago. I'd like to say thank you for your service to this community and to this county. And most of all, I'm grateful that I can call you my friend.
Mr. Covington, if you would come forward, please. We're not going to make you make a speech unless you'd like to, but it is my pleasure, and on behalf of our Board of Commissioners, the county staff, and the Board of Equalization Review, and your other supporters here, to present this plaque to you. I'd like to read it. The Alamance County Board of Commissioners expresses sincere appreciation to William Bill Covington for his unselfish devotion of time, energy, and ability to the people of Alamance County by serving on the Alamance County Board of Equalization and Review from 1993 to 2012, presented this 22nd day of January 2013 in Graham, North Carolina. Mr. Covington, thank you very much. Congratulations.
This board, I really didn't know what to expect, but after 20 years, and like Frank said, there's been some tough decisions, but overall, we looked at this, what the county appraisers have presented to us, and what some outside appraisers presented to us. And the tax thing was kind of out of kilter at one time where they were appraising some of this stuff. But we took a close look at it, and I hope the tax is more suitable for everybody today. The Equalization Board has worked hard on this, trying to get the county in different zones. When you change one man's tax, you got to look at everybody else that lives close to him to see if it's equal or not. And we got some good employees and appraisers here in the county now, and we hope it's on the ups and ups, and everybody gets what they hope is the right tax. Thank you.
Thank you, Bill, very much. We've got some representatives from Farm Bureau organization here with us in support of Mr. Covington. Thank you all for your attendance as well. Next on the agenda are a couple of budget amendments. The first one is in the Department of Social Services, and we're going to call on Susan Osborne to present those budget amendments at this time. Susan, welcome.
Good afternoon. Good evening. Just a couple of budget amendments for social services. Budget amendment number 55 is just a reconciliation of budgeted amounts that came in with our estimates and that we provided to the county during our budget time, and then we get the actual allocations after the state budget passes. So it's just reconciling those. The net is a gain of about $504,000. That's mostly in our energy funds. We do have some reductions other than what we expected in our daycare funds, and we have made appropriate reductions in services to reflect that reduction, and are actually issuing some changes to services that we're offering for daycare to meet that. And I'll be glad to answer any questions that you have.
That is your budget amendment number 55.
Yes, sir.
Why don't we act on that one before we look at the second one? Are there any questions for Susan about this $500,000 in this budget amendment proposal? If not, we entertain a motion. Is there one?
I make that motion.
Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Tim. Any other discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Number 56.
Number 56 is two of our federal grants. We did not expend as much money in those grants last year as we were budgeted. So we have passed our years on both those grants, but because we had leftover money and didn't use it all, we have a no-cost extension year. So this is allocating the unspent funds to a no-cost extension year so that we can continue the services for another year at no extra cost.
Questions for Susan on budget amendment 56?
One is our comprehensive family assessment grant that works with child welfare families to make sure that we're making appropriate assessments, and the other is our violence against women that funds some of our family justice center services.
Is there a motion to approve budget amendment 56?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Thank you,
Susan. Now we move over to the health department, and we'll call on Barry Bass, or who's representing Barry? Barry's representing Barry. Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Two budget amendments from the health department.
Yes, sir. If I may ask you all, I'd like to introduce a young lady who is visiting with us tonight, and her name's Courtney Stover, and Courtney is a sophomore at Elon University and has an interest in government and public health. So ask her if she'd be interested in coming.
Courtney, I'm glad you're here.
The first budget we have before you, number 57, is a $100,000 grant that we're getting from the state on our Project Launch. You may remember that Project Launch is our early childhood intervention program that we've been working on, and the state has been so impressed with how we've been doing our Triple P program. And actually, we're so proud because Alamance County, we're actually doing a better job than the people that they funded for Triple P. So we're feeling really good about how that's moving forward and the recognition that we've gotten. And this extra $100,000 will be used to train some additional folks in our community, staff from our hospital. We're using police officers with the community policing program, our SROs in the schools. We're going to be training some of those folks in this, extending to a lot of the social workers who are with our at the school system. And, of course, folks with our DSS and the health department. But, these funds will enable us to expand our Triple P, and it'll, I think, really help our community as folks are able to, identify and work with families who may be dealing with their children who have emotional issues or maybe have behavioral issues. And, this is a great opportunity to train more folks to be able to do that. So far in Alamance County, we have 45 Triple P accredited practitioners. We have five who are pending accreditation, and we are in the process of today and tomorrow of training another 20 people. So we're, you know, the goal initially was to do 100 people. We're probably going to do more than that. So again, this is all state funds. It would not require any local match. It's a straight grant from the Division of Public Health.
Barry, if I'm not mistaken, I think the hospital actually has been recognized for working with you in some of these joint programs.
That's correct. They will receive their award tomorrow. The Association, North Carolina Association of Local Health Directors, will be awarding them our North Carolina leadership, our partnership, statewide partnership award for public health.
Congratulations.
So, yes, sir.
Congratulations to them as well.
Absolutely. We're a great partner.
Any questions?
What are you training these people to do?
Well, basically, the Triple P is a parenting program, and it enables one looking at the behaviors of children and how you can start working with the children and how to deal with behaviors. And also, in Alamance County, we have a behavioral health specialist in two of our medical practices, along with a family partner. So if the physician is doing an examination and they find that the child may have a special need, that they can start working with that family on site. That's one of the key components that we're excited. This is a new model of providing services where the folks are actually embedded, at the medical practices. And we're hoping to expand that to another practice over the next year or so. But we've got two right now that are working with us, two pediatric practices, and are, again, looking at early intervention and trying to help the parents as well as the children. And making sure that if we identify that there may be issues, that we can go ahead and get the child into, if they need referrals to other behavioral health specialists, to try to have really good outcomes with the children.
What are you going to spend the $100,000 doing?
Well, basically, it's to expand our Triple P training.
You got to pay employees to.
Oh no, there's no, absolutely not. This
you got to buy something. What are you buying?
Well, we're actually.
I saw what you had in your information.
We're buying the training from Triple P America, which is out of Columbia, South Carolina, and that's part of it. Is that they're going to be coming up and they'll be doing the training, and by bringing them here, we have to pay them for the folks who are enrolled in the training. So basically, we're paying them to train our folks in our community. So that's the majority of it. But also, as part of that, we'll be using it to, as you can see, we'll be using it to buy materials such as tip sheets and workbooks and parenting books and things such as that. So it goes back to educational materials.
What are you training this Latino community partners? What is that all about?
Well, we have a special needs population, and it would include them. We have a contract with El Centro Community Dodd and the faith community here. As you may know, that is run from the diocese out of Raleigh. So it's basically a faith-based community organization, so we're providing training to some of their staff so they can work with their particular folks in their community. This particular grant goes across our entire continuum of folks in our community.
Now, how many other counties are doing this, Director?
We're the only one on North. Oh, you're, yes. This happened before you became on the board.
Yeah, I'm asking some serious questions.
Yes, sir. And we're the only one in North Carolina. Alamance County got the award last year, and this is like our first full year of implementation. We have two more years remaining on the grant, and so far it looks like we may be able to extend that by one more year. So again, it's looking at families and children in our community and looking for opportunities to find folks who may be having issues with their families. Part of it, we want to keep them out of the court system. We want to keep them out of jails and make sure that we are addressing behavior problems early in life so these kids can do well in school. They can receive the support that they need. And again, help the families to be able to work with the children and deal with the issues also.
I'd like to ask a question. Tony, maybe both of you can interrelate. Number one, have we still got a couple hundred homeless children in Alamance County, what we would call homeless?
800.
They were
over 800 now.
Stunning. Last time I looked at it, it was just 200 or something.
Yeah.
That's what's happening, not only in America, but in Alamance County. I mean, what about teen suicides in Alamance County? You don't know of any? Now, in Guilford, they've had several.
We've had several.
Yes.
But They've had several in Greensboro, and it's stunning. The kids are taking, they're slicing themselves. I mean, I get them in my car, and I can see the scars on that arm. And it just breaks my heart. I had one that's committed suicide way after I had her in my car, and I didn't know about it until a year or two after it happened. It broke my heart. I don't think we had the slightest idea what's going on.
Thank
unless
you.
You're out there with children, unless you see them every day.
And that's part of what we're trying to do with this grant is like do the early intervention and try to find those folks when they're young.
The signs are there if you just act upon it.
Yes, sir. And that's part of what Triple P does is to give the training where you can recognize them. So I think the more folks that we're talking about in our community in different positions who interact with kids, again, like, you know, law enforcement, the school system, the social service agencies, and the, obviously the private medical practitioners and medical community. Yes, sir.
Well, I would like to say, too, you know, I'm on the health board, and I'm also on DSS board, and I would like to see some of the commissioners come to these board meetings, and because you really learn a lot at the board meetings, a whole lot more than you do if you read anything in the paper, and I just want to say that because it's certainly a fact that what goes on in the Board of Health and the Board of DSS is very informative, and I just feel like that, you know, if I could get some of y'all to go with me, I'll certainly be glad to tell you when it is. So.
What's considered a homeless child in Alamance?
It's done by the federal government in the McKinney-Vento Act, and there are several definitions.
What's the broadest definition of a homeless child in Alamance County?
Well, there's a lot of broad definitions.
Well, give me one.
Well, doubling up, it would be one, so someone who's living with another family, two families living together, would be considered a homeless under McKinney-Vento.
See, Myrtle Beach has got, last time I checked with our office is 200-something, because I'd read about where Myrtle Beach had 300-something. Still telling if ours is high now where theirs is, but it's just stunning.
It's not just who's in the shelter. It's, mm-hmm. yeah. it's defined by the federal government.
Thank you for those comments. This is budget amendment number 57. Is there a motion for approval?
So moved.
Thank you, Bill. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Any other discussion or questions? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Thank you.
How about number 58?
All right, number 58 we got some additional funding from the March of Dimes for our Centering Pregnancy Program. And our Centering Pregnancy is a best practice, and what it allows us is that we're able to do like women who come in who are pregnant to a group, and they do like a group, and it's kind of like the younger moms are able to bond with some of the older moms, and we provide like a lot of information, and they get like all of their services in a group as opposed to doing the traditional one-on-one. So this is an evidence-based practice, and the March of Dimes is giving us enough. We had funding to go through December 31st. This will enable us to run the program until June the 30th. And we're looking for additional funding to go forward to sustain it, but this will allow us in the interim to do that. So that's what this $17,000 is for, to continue our Centering Pregnancy Program.
Now, will the March of Dimes, are you on their list for possible funds then going forward after June 30?
No, sir, because I think this is the third year that they funded us. So at this point, in order for us to, and most of the funding goes to support the activities of the program, but it also goes to help pay for a part-time coordinator. And that's the lady who leads our program. So it may mean that we may have to have some of our existing staff to be able to do that. You know, it is an additional duty.
After June 30.
Correct. But so the idea is to keep someone who we've got there who's been doing this work for the past couple of years to continue with her. But again, it's going to be contingent upon finding the funding from another nonprofit or foundation.
Any other questions on Amendment 58? Is there a motion for approval?
So moved. Okay, second. I'll second it.
Whatever.
One of us will do.
Tori, figure that one out. All in favor, say aye. Any opposed?
Thank you, Barry. Sir.
Courtney, thank you for joining us. Good luck in your studies. It's your first
May
day of school.
She's from, where are you from?
Virginia Beach.
Oh, you lucky rascal.
Item number 9, we'd now like to call on Mr. Greg Thomas, our director of our solid waste facility, landfill, approval of a recycling processing facility at the county landfill, and the adoption of a resolution to hire a local architect design firm. Correct?
Good evening, Commissioners. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for the opportunity to appear on behalf of our landfill. The landfill is proposing to construct a pre-engineered metal building to serve as a recycling processing facility at the landfill. As you know, recycling is an integral function of the landfill operation, generating more than 19,725 tons of recyclables, resulting in sales of more than 788,000 over the past 5 years, while increasing more than 50% in the past 2 years. Recyclables, including cardboard, newspaper, glass bottles, aluminum cans, and plastics, would continue to be collected through our drop sites located at Pleasant Grove, Daly Waterwheel Road, and the landfill. The proposed 8,000 square foot building would enable the processing, separation, and baling of these materials to be performed indoors and out of the elements. Our burgeoning electronic or e-waste program would also be consolidated into this single facility, which has been on the drawing board for more than a year. This larger and indoor facility would allow us to better manage the storage, marketing, and competitive price selling of these baled commodities in bulk, as opposed to the current smaller piecemeal loads of lesser volumes. The larger loads will also serve to reduce transportation costs. A major additional program is the receiving, separation, storage, and transport of more than 150,000 scrap tires that come to our landfill annually. The proposed facility will allow us to shore up our tire management by processing the tires through the planned building, incorporating a loading dock, and decreasing some manual labor man hours. This would represent a remarkable improvement compared to our current collection site that is more subject to potential mosquito and rodent harborage. The state requires the tire processing and the storage area be covered to prevent rainwater accumulation. A lesser but needed aspect of the building would be its use during closed hours as a parking garage for motorized vehicles, including trucks, forklifts, and other riding mowers. In summary, the facility would be a tremendous asset that would strengthen our recycling operation, making it more efficient, effective, and streamline our workflow. Its storage of baled bulk recyclables would make us less vulnerable to market swings, and it would offer the flexibility and potential in the future to work more closely with our cities and towns relative to managing Alamance County recyclables on a broader scale. The current year's budget provides $300,000 for the support of this project. With the continued support and approval of the Board of Commissioners, we would like to move forward with this process. In an effort to expedite the preliminary steps of the project, the attached resolution would allow us to work with a local professional architect and engineering firm to plan, design, and oversee construction. We will work closely with county purchasing to advertise and secure competitive bids, which will be presented for your review and action at a later date. Thank you so much for your time and consideration, and I'll be glad to answer any questions that the board might have.
Greg, how much did you estimate it cost?
We placed it at $300,000, Commissioner Smith. What we don't know is the construction market, so we don't know what they'll involve. We know that it's going to be a significant amount of concrete and docks in this project, so my message to the board would be, certainly if it's $200,000, we can support it, but if it's $400,000, we can support it, but we want to get the most bang for the buck with our landfill dollars, and again, we have been planning this for some time.
Where are you going to put it out there?
We have a area across from our tire facility that's about 3 acres that will it's already graded and level, so it will be a really good area for
that. Toward the front?
Yes sir.
Greg or Craig, can you all just take a minute and explain to our group here a little bit about the nature of the landfill being an enterprise fund? It's certainly the largest enterprise fund that we have in Alamance County, and what you're talking about, and you mentioned it here in your correspondence, that you actually obviously charge to process the recyclables, and,
right,
and your sales have gone up over the past few years. Can
right.
you talk a little bit about that?
And again, as you mentioned, enterprise fund, which means that we operate solely on tipping fees. When I mention recycling revenues, what happens Chairman Manning, is we process the recycles. We have a baler, a machine that bales our materials, and we purchased this about 3 years ago. Prior to that, we were marketing our recycled materials in a loose, we were just sending them to market in an open container, and we were netting less revenue because we were not getting the tonnage. When we bale, and I'll use cardboard as an example, we can potentially get 1,000 pounds of cardboard in a bale. Prior to that, we were just shipping it open and in loose form, and we were not getting as much money for that product. So, and then as far as our enterprise fund, we charge per ton for trash that comes into our landfill at a rate of, our fee is $36 a ton, but the state has imposed in 2008 a $2 per ton solid waste fee, which makes our tipping fee $38 a ton. But these monies all go to support all landfill and recycling operations, and we do not use any tax dollars. The 52-cent rate does not go to support any landfill or recycling operations.
Nor would it support the capital investment you're talking about.
That's correct. Yes, sir, the tax rate you're speaking of. You're exactly right. But if I could speak a little bit about that, we don't take for granted our monies because we have the state requires us to have closure and post-closure monies in the amount of currently of about $12.2 million. So, and I hear frequently in different areas, well, the landfill has money. And with good reason, we've planned ahead. Our leaders in the past have put us in the predicament and present, have put us in the positive situation that we now enjoy. We have the monies for closure and post-closure, and as recently as 2005, we did a $3.7 million expansion. And so it's important that we have monies to purchase equipment. It's important that we have monies to sustain our day in and day out operations. So we're very frugal with our money, and we have to be. We purchase equipment, and it's very expensive. So while we do not use tax dollars, we take it very seriously.
That landfill is state of the art out there. It is, and Greg's crew really do a good job, excellent job. And if any of you folks haven't been out there, it's really a place to go and see what they do.
Thank you, sir.
And one other thing, the money that they raise in the landfill cannot be used for anything but the land running the landfill. And
I have that document with me. I thought about that today.
I tried. I called the LGC and said, can I even borrow some of the money out there? No, you can't do it.
But yeah, I have that document. I thought about that today. That's a good point. But again, I'm very proud of the staff that I have at the landfill. And I know your leadership in the past has been an integral part of that, as well as the leadership of our current.
We had an alligator out there one time, too.
Greg, did you wrestle?
Sir,
I was going to ask what his name was.
Did you wrestle the alligator?
No, sir, I did not.
I didn't believe it until I saw a picture in the paper of it.
Yeah, that was interesting. Ms. Missman, I'm working towards my third decade there, and I've seen some things at our landfill, but very, very proud to serve this county and in my current capacity. So
well, and you do it well, and I'll just agree and second what Commissioner Smith said about if you haven't been out there, you need to go, and if you go and get fortunate enough to have Greg give you a tour, then you're really in for a treat. So item calls for the approval of a recycling processing facility at the landfill and also the adoption of the resolution to hire a local architect design firm. And I believe you've selected Allie Williams Carmen King, is that
yes,
right?
Yes, sir, we
as
have.
The architect.
Yes, sir, and that is listed on the resolution. And Mr. Albright's office assisted us with that as well as purchasing, so I appreciate their assistance.
So move.
Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Bill. David, any other discussion or questions?
Yes.
I'm sorry, this is not a public meeting at this time, and comments from our audience are for public comment time, but thank you. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you, Greg.
Yes,
good luck.
Sir. Thank you so much.
Next, we have a grant application request for Cedar Rock Park. Brian, good evening, sir.
Good evening, Commissioners. I'm here this evening to request that you consider allowing our department to apply for $180,000 in grant funds. These funds would be from the North Carolina Recreational Trails Program. It's administered through the North Carolina State Parks Division. Our intent, if we apply and are successful on getting the grant funds, we would put them with other monies that we put together to buy approximately 78 acres of open space adjacent to Cedar Rock Park. This is land that, as you pull into the park, you remember, it's on the right-hand side of the road along the main drive. The main purpose we would have in purchasing this land is to preserve it. That's the main thing, to maintain the natural setting of the park and protect it. The property is owned by two different property owners, and they have been very gracious and willing to work with us as we've tried to secure as many grants as possible and outside funding to make this work. And they remain committed to working with us as we go through these processes. This grant, this particular grant, does require a 25% match. However, we already have several grants in hand in amounts large enough that that would make our match. So it wouldn't be necessary for the county to commit general fund monies to do that. In fact, our department has already, with your approval, secured over $245,000 from the North Carolina Parks and Recreation Trust Fund toward this project. You've also approved us to apply for and receive $50,000 from the North Carolina Water Resources Grant. And we've also worked with the community, several churches and businesses, and we've been able to raise about $25,000 toward this project just through donations, sponsorships of certain things at the park, as well as fundraising events that we put on ourselves. Basically, if we're able to apply for these funds, this $180,000, and we're successful in getting it, we would be able to then buy the property, the entire 78 acres, without having to go to the county's general fund to make that happen. We've had two goals here, is to secure the property and try to limit the financial impact to the county, particularly to the county's general fund. With this particular grant, North Carolina Recreation Trails Program, we've had a lot of success. We've had four different grant attempts that you've approved and we've applied for that were successful for about $300,000 since 2007, so we're very familiar with this grant. We feel like there's a good chance, we can't guarantee anything, but we feel like there's a very good chance that if we apply, it will be funded. So at this time, if you have any questions, I'd be happy to try to answer them and ask you to consider allowing us to apply.
How many acres would that make the park?
It would be just a little over 500. Existing is 414, so this would add another 78 to it.
Well, again, Brian has done a great job out there at Cedar Rock, and that is also a state-of-the-art park, and it's another great place to visit.
Thank you. A lot of, and all that's attributable to staff, and a lot of staff have worked very hard trying to put together these grants. As you all know, this is a tough time, and they've had to be very resourceful to try to find different ways to make this happen, but I think they've done a very good job.
So moved.
Thank you, David.
Second.
Is there a second?
Second.
Bill, thank you. Any other questions or discussion for Brian? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Good luck. Keep us posted on how it goes. This time we'll call on our county manager, Craig Honeycutt, for his report.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. In front of you tonight is our follow-up to the Local Government Commission. As you're aware, when our fund balance fell to 7.83%, the Local Government Commission asked for a response from the county on where we are and where we're going with respect to our fund balance. And we have taken steps to try to address our fund balance issues, and we have listed five items that we've done. Again, we actually had an increase in fund balance for 11-12. We do feel like our fund balance is improving. Also, we in the 12-13 budget, we did not appropriate any fund balance to balance the budget. And we also set aside almost $270,000 in contingency that we've not used yet. So if that's not used, we'll be able to put that money into fund balance as well. Again, looking at our six-month comparison that the board got a copy of, we are positive over this time last year, and we're hopefully we'll see that trend continuing. Again, we've made deep cuts within our operating budget. And again, we've talked about no salary increases or capital purchases have been funded in this year. And also, we did talk about our performance-based budgeting and the goal that we have to set a 15% minimum goal before we begin using some of those savings from our performance-based budgeting. But also, I think an important thing is to see that our 12-13 budget ordinance was $4.8 million less than the 11-12 budget. So we are doing the things to take the right steps to move forward and to try to address our fund balance issue. It's been a slow process, but it's like we talked about at the six-month look at our budget, we're in the black. And I enjoy being in the black a whole lot more than the red. So with your approval, this will be sent to the LGC as our response back under the chairman's signature.
And everyone prior to this evening had received this for review. Is that right?
They did, and I apologize to Commissioner Smith. I don't believe his email was working, and I...
I've read it though.
Yeah, okay. But I do apologize.
Well, I fixed his email.
We're going to take care of it for him. So yes, sir.
It's right. Not the machine's problem.
It's not the arrow. It's the Indian. All right. Okay. Is this something we need to have a motion for approval?
It really doesn't require one, but I wanted to make sure the board was comfortable with what was being presented back to the local government commission.
Okay. Does any board member feel that we need a motion, and or are we okay just moving forward?
Move forward.
Okay.
All right.
Update on Graham Manor?
First, I do want to thank Brian, Richard, and also Dave Leonard for the work that they've done on this. We actually have received three bids for the demolition of Graham Manor. The total on that is $224,460. The demolition is really not the big cost. The big cost was the asbestos abatement, which ended up being almost $70,000. One of the issues that we did talk about with the board was looking at burning it. And we've met with the Graham Fire Chief, and there's a couple of issues that they have with respect to trying to burn the building. The fire would smolder for days, thus emitting excessive amounts of smoke into the neighborhood. Additional asbestos abatement of roofing materials would be required prior to the burn. And potential wall collapse and heat damage to central permitting during final burn down phase of the training. So there is a concern about burning. So that's the reason why we're looking at demolition. But there is funding in our capital buildings fund, you know, the remaining money that we had left over from our $9.2 million in facilities improvements. If we did use $224,460, that would leave us $108,175. And then we do have about $75,000 of that committed to fixing the fire alarm in this building.
The $224,000,
That was the total,
but
yes,
that
sir.
Includes the $70,000 for the asbestos.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir. Actual demolition was about $118,000. And I do also want to thank Greg at the landfill. We're going to be able to carry the brick and the concrete down to the landfill and won't be charged for that because they'll be crushing that up and using that as kind of a dry run on the road. So there's some savings there by using that at the landfill.
Have the masons gotten in there yet, Greg?
No, sir. We're waiting to hear back from them. We're trying to set a public event with them and do a press release, but we wouldn't do anything with the building until we had full approval of the masons.
Do you want to share that story and the situation with our meeting folks here?
Craig can tell him. I think he got into it before, and Tim knows about it too.
I was ordering a hot dog one day, and he said, "You better not tear it down and let us get our box out of it."
Well, and what the box is, it's a time capsule.
Yeah, I don't know anything about it other than he said we need to find it, and I said I'd get it to everybody concerned. That's the last I did with it. So.
They know where it is, and they just want to get it out before the building's torn down.
And I think a celebration or a schedule.
Right, we were thinking about doing kind of a public event, inviting the press and the Masons to come and open it and themselves, but I think there's three or four Mason chapters within the county or around that they were trying to coordinate a time. And we just don't have that date yet. But we would not do anything until we've got their blessing.
Do we know when the time capsule was placed?
70s?
It was 1970s, early 70s.
Well, what a change that's going to be.
But with the board's approval, and again, we received three bids on this, and the low bid on that was D.H. Griffin. So if the board feels like, you know, that demolition is the right thing to do, we have the bids, and it would just take a motion from the board to move forward, or we can delay is whatever you so choose.
D.H. Griffin is also the company that is investing in your old stomping grounds, Ms. Linda.
There's four things going in there now.
Your current stomping grounds.
Yeah,
she's still stomping.
I'm still stomping around down there.
I misspoke.
I seen her dancing a couple of Saturdays ago.
What is the board's sentiment on proceeding with the demolition? What are we spending now for taking care of the place?
We were looking at, I think it was going to be, off the top of my head, around $15,000 or $20,000 to go in and repair the roof, board up all the windows. There's work that needs to be done to the facility no matter what, if we continue to let it stand, to prevent people from being able to get in it. And it's taking water in pretty good between all the floors, which we would ask, I'd have to put those numbers together and come back, because we would want to pay for it out of this capital buildings fund if the board would do that. So that would need to be done if nothing, no other action is taken with the bill.
What do y'all think?
Not going to get any cheaper.
I say tear it down. I'll make the motion. We tear it down.
Second. Okay. Bill's made the motion. A second by Tim. Other discussion, comments, questions? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Tear it down.
We will coordinate with the Masons and coordinate with D.H. Griffin.
Are you talking to Jim up at Jim's Hot Dog?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
That's the only one I knew. Yeah. So. At least call.
And also Lash Reitenberry has, I've talked to Lash a couple of times, and so we'll coordinate to make sure it's done right.
Thank you, Craig. What else?
That is all I have this evening. Thank you.
Commissioners, comments?
When did you say the budget retreat would be?
The original date that you had for the budget retreat was what?
We originally, it's April 15th is what we have scheduled now. Commissioner Manning was unable to be here on the 1st.
Well, you can do it without me.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean. Yeah. But right now we've scheduled it for the 15th.
That would be a special meeting, not part of a regular meeting.
Right.
I'm just going to be gone that first week. So.
Right.
You're not going to say Uncle Sam, are
you? On the 15th? Yeah. That's why I'm leaving.
But we have already sent out budget packages to the departments, and they're starting to formulate their budgets now.
And I think everyone received kind of a tentative budget schedule that you sent out. But the conflict that I mentioned wasn't necessarily among members of the board on the 15th, but a couple of the department heads may have conflict. We can work around that.
Is this open to the public?
The budget meetings, budget retreats, yes.
Yes, it is.
Well, last year we had it at the May Memorial Library. I don't know that a location has been
selected. We're still looking at May.
But we'll, we're looking at May Library.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Which, downtown Burlington? They have a meeting in there that...
I'm sorry, what's the start date?
Well, tentatively, it was April 15th, but we'll address that. We had a couple of people that were going to be out of town on the 15th. I'm not one of those.
We'll recheck and make sure we get that date nailed down.
During the budget retreat, are you going to bring up the issue of GS-153A?
I believe that the chairman also would like to have that discussion tonight.
Before?
I think tonight he would like.
Which one is that? Because I've got HB-438.
Social Services.
Yeah. Okay, 438, yeah. David, thank you. I'll use that to segue in a couple of comments and schedule discussions. And the first one is House Bill 438, which was passed last June by the state legislature. And basically what this bill allows is for county commissioners to get involved and be involved in the restructuring of the boards of the local Board of Health and the local Department of Social Services Board. And we've got several options. One is to keep everything the way it is. One is to adopt a resolution basically that would result in the two heads of those departments becoming departments under the county and reporting to the county manager. If that were to occur, there would be a health advisory committee established with membership currently required for the Board of Health. Another option is to create just one human services agency that would be both inclusive of Board of Health and Social Services. And a final option is to have a board formed, but the board would be basically the same board that serves on the county commission. And again, that's a little complex, but that's what the law allows. And I think what we would like to do is get that, not necessarily on the budget agenda, but for discussion in this meeting. And had we thought about a specific time?
Well, and we have had some preliminary discussions amongst staff and with Brian and also with Barry and Susan about potential options and how to move forward. One of the things we would like to look from the board is making sure this is the direction you want us to put some time to and come back with options to you for how we can look at reorganization and how we can look at them, you know, the options of them becoming county departments or true county departments without the separate boards, you know. So that there's a lot that's built into it. There's a lot of responsibilities that if the board so chose to sit as the DSS and health board, that you'll have to take on that responsibility. So we wanted to make sure that we gave you all that information so you could make the best decision for Alamance County. We were in talking with the chairman, just wanted to make sure that is your blessing and the direction you want us to go, so that because it's going to take some time and effort on staff's point to get to that point.
And that's what we need is there consensus to at least get staff to lay out the options in more detail than I just said, so we can study it and make an intelligent decision.
I say yes.
Well, what I said before, I think y'all need to come to the board meeting.
I was on the health board for about 12 years.
But the DSS board is totally different from the health board. And where they get their money from is totally different. Mm-hmm. And that's why I think that I would like to see at least come to one of their health board and the DSS board meetings before we decide. I've worked in both places. I've worked in DSS and I've worked in the health department mm-hmm. as a supervisor. And I am not for it, I'll tell you right now. But I would like for y'all to come and see what the boards do, because you don't have a clue.
I do. I was on their board for social service 2.5 years.
Well,
I resigned off that board.
Tim was born on the county commission.
Yeah, I got to be honest with you. I resigned it because it was a lot of negative talk. I mean, constant. I mean, it's...
Well, it's not that way now.
Well, it was when I was there.
It's not now.
You know,
I've been to enough of those meetings already myself.
Well,
yeah. But again...
I'm all in favor of moving and putting it under the manager.
I am too.
Well, again, I think...
But I'll listen to all of the options if he wants to go.
And again, it's going to take a lot of time for SAP time to make sure we give you all that information that you need. We've had, again, preliminary discussions, and I've asked Brian to kind of head up working with Barry and Susan, the staff end of that, or the management end on that. So be working with Brian on that.
So when do you think this board could hear... not the detail, but kind of the summary options where we would have enough information to give you guidance on which way to go?
What we would probably like that the board's agreeable is let now that we have a clear direction from the board, is let us come back to the get together, kind of set out a time frame of what it's going to take and a timeline, and maybe come back in a couple of weeks at our next meeting just to give you a quick overview of where we're at and how much time we think it's going to take and when we can get all the information you need, if we can do that in a couple of weeks.
Can we submit questions?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Please, any questions, comments, concerns, please let either myself or Brian know. There's a couple of instances where the wheel has already been invented. New Hanover County is looking at this, I believe. Buncombe County, Mecklenburg County, and there may be a couple other counties as well.
Pender.
Wake's got it too.
We can call Tim Burgess down in New Hanover and see how Tim's doing it. So.
Okay, we'll proceed on.
We will proceed on it, and we'll give you an update at our next meeting.
Thank you, Craig.
All right, thank
you. The next item I just want to briefly cover. As you know, we had something like 94% success last year in completing the Alamance Orange County line issue. And then, Clyde, if I can ask you of memory, we then did something to appease the remaining property owners to where we've got pretty much a final plan in place.
A year later, we had another bill, and it's done.
And that was a lot of work on your part, on
5 years
Scott's part, and a lot of Bruce's part. A lot of folks were involved in that.
I thought Eddie Jeremy. Shoot took care of that.
Eddie left. I'm sorry, he can't respond to that. Which brings us to kind of the other side of the county, and I'm really glad that Mayor Williams is here. Lenny, welcome to you. You come to the platform if you'd like. Because we have a situation, it's a little different, but it's the same principle on the Alamance-Guilford side, and I think it would be in both counties' best interest to come to some kind of agreement. I received, as you all did, an email from a resident that is really in an unfortunate situation. He lives actually in Lake McIntosh on the county line. And it's a terrible story because he got billed from both counties, and there was an agreement that he only had to pay one set of taxes, which he did, but then the other county apparently contacted his mortgage company. The mortgage company contacted the other county and basically requested money, and the other county had no choice but to fund it, and therefore the gentleman was billed twice and ended up paying twice, got refunds back, but then it happened again. And then while he was waiting for the resolution on the Guilford side of the double taxation, he was charged interest from Guilford County on the funds. It was a big mess. It still is. And that's not the way to do business, in my opinion.
That's just one of many.
Yeah, it's terrible. So we need to do something, and again, the reason, Lenny, I'm glad that you're here is we were hoping that Gibsonville might at least host a place where we could meet with the Guilford County folks. Now, hear me out.
It's already been done.
It's already been done. You're absolutely right.
I'm not saying no, I'm saying yes.
Oh, well, when you go like that to me means no, forget it. But a couple
Lenny's
of things.
Got plenty of money. He can handle it.
Well, Lenny's going to host it, and didn't we say Lenny was going to pay for it?
That's a supply of lunch for everybody.
Kimber's restaurant.
What? And seriously, what's happened since the last discussion, which really didn't go anywhere, is the Guilford County Board has been reorganized, and they used to have something like 9 people, and I think now they have 7 people.
They had 11,
and now they have
9.
Okay. And I've actually informally met and talked to 5 of those 9, where they said, well, yeah, you know, we need to get this fixed. And they have some opinions that are different than some of our opinions. They have some opinions that are the same as our opinions. So, at any rate, I say that because I would like to ask Craig to talk to his counterpart or interim counterpart in Guilford County to maybe set up something and certainly involve you as the municipality that straddles both counties to maybe help us facilitate it and just get everybody together and talk about it. Is that something the board's okay with? Craig?
Yeah. Lenny is the man.
Good. Then you and Lenny get together and find out whoever your counterpart is. Maybe an interim now, right?
Well, Ben's the manager in Gibsonville, and Brenda Jones-Fox, I think it's through the end of the month, if I'm not
mistaken.
February.
Have they named someone to replace her?
Yes,
Lenny?
Cherise, the assistant manager.
Oh, okay. Well, that's good. At least she has a history of what we're doing. Okay.
She's leaving.
So proceed on that, Craig, if you would, as well. And then the last thing, I emailed to each of you the individual performance evaluations for Craig and for Clyde and for Gerald. I saw Gerald's still here. That our part needs to be complete by the next meeting, which is the first meeting in February, which will be in the morning. What I'd like to do is go into closed session following that meeting and talk individually with Mr. Honeycutt and with Mr. Albright, and then at the next morning meeting, we'll hear from them about their reaction to our input and also discuss with Jeremy about responsibilities for the tax administrator for the coming year. So everybody got that? If you did not get it or have trouble pulling it up, Tori can help us with that. Other comments? Anybody have anything? Any announcements? If not, appreciate everybody's time. Thank you all for being here. Stand adjourned.
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the County Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 o'clock p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says Alamance County Commissioners to visit the commissioners' website, where you can learn about our commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.